She's not trustworthy, so somebody follow her up. Because I preached on this at the women's retreat, and all the moms said, go tell my kids this. For real. For real. All right, so I was 5 years old. You couldn't tell I was a girl. I had freckles all over my face. I had holes in my knees and in my jeans. I broke multiple arms by the time I was 5 or 6. I really only have 2 arms, but multiple breaks. And we were in a trailer park. I don't know what state. I lived in 32 by the time I graduated from high school. So anyway, trailer park, tow-headed little girl who you can't even tell is a girl. And my brother's a year older than I, and we're out playing. And this little boy, our neighbor kid, he's older than us, was hanging out. And all of a sudden, like, we were playing, I don't even remember what it was. But at one point, I'm on the ground, and the kid's on top of me, just pounding on me. And I remember at 5, 6 years old, going, that hurts. Why is he playing so rough? What is going on? And my brother is like, Jennifer, hit him back. And I'm like, what? He's like, hit him back. You're in a fight. I'm like, I'm in a fight? Yeah, you're in a fight. Hit him back. And I'd never been given permission to hit. So I'm like, yeah. So I just start pounding on this kid. And of course, my brother, as any good brother should, jumps in as well. And my mom looks out the kitchen window and sees my brother and I just annihilating this neighbor kid. She comes out, grabs us both, takes us inside. We don't hit. And I'm like, but I was in a fight. Mom, it was my first fight. I was in a fight. I hit him. I hurt him. And my brother's like, but she didn't even know she was in a fight. I had to tell her. Tonight, you guys are in a fight. Spiritually, you are getting the snot pounded out of you, and you don't even know you're in a fight. You're laying there, and somebody's looking at you going, you're in a fight. And you're like, am I really? Is this happening on purpose? Am I really in a fight? I am telling you right now, you are in a fight. Period. Every single person in this room, you are in a fight. How many of you in this room are first-time visitors? Okay, I'll be gentle with you. 2 Timothy 1:7, that's in the Bible, it's towards the end of the New Testament. It says, God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. God, the creator of the universe, did not give you a spirit of fear. He gave you a power of, or fear, power, love, sound mind. Power, say it.
Power.
Love, and a sound mind.
Sound mind.
Okay, read the statistics. 8 years ago, they said 10% of all teenagers experience fear or anxiety. 3 years ago, statistics said 50% of teenagers experience fear and anxiety. 2 weeks ago, the report comes out, 75% of teenagers experience fear and anxiety. That means maybe this part of the room doesn't, but everybody else in this room experiences fear. What did 2 Timothy say? God did not give us a spirit of
fear,
but 75% of us walk in it. So why are we walking in something God didn't give us? Because you're in a fight, and you don't even know you're in a fight. You're not realizing it. Because when you are in a fight and you realize it, you make a difference. You do something about it. The pressure put on you guys is astronomical. In grades, in sports, in just being the best at everything, your generation grieves us in prayer because we feel so bad for you. Because if you mess up on one little thing, you can repeat that over and over and over in your mind for years on end. That is not from God. That is directly from the guy, Satan, who's pounding on your face. God didn't give it to you. A phobia is an unreasonable, something you will avoid at whatever the cost. Things like spiders, snakes, heights, Now that we've done that survey, flying, crowds, dogs, storms, elevators, germs, which we also have now that nobody washes their hands, flying, holes, meaning like grates in the ground or like a deep hole. People can be phobic of those things. That is an uncontrollable fear. Like if I gave you a bunch of spiders right now, some of you would scream and leave, okay? Right? Are you tracking me? The difference between a fear is a fear is like you're uneasy, you're worried. You have a sudden reaction to something that could be dangerous. A phobia is fight or flight. You're out of there. There's no way you're gonna stay if there's a snake in this room. Or you're gonna go kill the snake in this room. Like it's an either or. So we have funky little phobias. People can be afraid of belly buttons. Anybody in here? We have counseling available, anyone?
Bill says he has an Audi.
Okay, you have an Audi, Bill. People can be afraid of hair. They can be afraid of light. Numbers, you can be afraid of numbers. And you can be afraid of bananas. If there was 100 people in this room, one of you would be afraid of bananas. Phobias are uncontrollable. Uncontrollable. You don't have a choice, your body's gonna react to it. The world will give you a bunch of ways to overcome those things, but we're not talking about the world's ways of overcoming them. We're gonna talk about God's way of overcoming them. So, we have our fear, which is general unease. And we have phobias, which is uncontrollable. If there's a snake, I'm freaking out. There's this other thing called anxiety. And anxiety is there's absolutely no danger right now. There's nothing in this room to be afraid of. However, we think that it's going to happen at any minute. And we're so concerned about thinking about that anxiety that we can't think of anything else. You're worrying it might happen. You're anticipating that it might happen, and there's actually nothing happening right now. That is an anxiety. An anxiety is, I'm going to school, and we're gonna be evacuated because of an emergency situation. Anxiety is, it might rain tonight, and there might be a tornado, so I can't sleep because it might happen. But I would like to propose that the anxiety that you guys would deal with the most is called a social phobia, which is renamed into a social anxiety disorder, which initials are SAD, social anxiety disorder. And this would be fear of judgment, fear of interaction or talking to someone. Fear that people will notice something about you. Might notice you're sweating, you're blushing, you're shaking, your voice might be shaking, you might have acne, your nose might flare. You have fear of being the center of attention. My youngest one is ready to be baptized and she flat out won't do it because people are gonna look at her. She flat out won't do it, even for Jesus. She's like, no, people are gonna look at me. Then we have anticipation of an anxiety or event. You know ACT's coming, and you're already anxious about it, and you might even just be in sixth grade. Nobody in this room, but I'm just saying. You know something's coming. A social situation. Anybody in this room already anxious about prom or graduation? Birthday parties make me anxious because I don't have them. My birthday's the day after Christmas. So I had one, and I'm like, what do I do with this? I don't even know. Your performance, if you play sports, if you play a musical instrument, there are so many things in that you can get anxious about. So signs of anxiety, you have trembling, twitching, fatigue, headache, feeling of dread, lack of confidence in yourself, sleeping problems, heart beating fast, sweaty hands. Anybody in this room, you don't have to raise your hands, deal with some of those? Okay, raise your hand, do it. It is a high probability that most of you in this room have some type of anxiety that comes against you. Whenever we walk in anxiety, It can make us feel very helpless, like I'm stuck in my head and I can't get out. I am having these headaches, or I can't sleep, or something's going on with me. My heart's beating fast and I just can't seem to stop. I can't get a hold of it. Nothing can help this. And it makes us feel like those feelings are true. We think it's a fact. Whenever you're anxious about a test, your brain kind of shuts down. You go into this place where you're like, man, I can't even think. And when you can't think, all of a sudden you're thinking, I can't think, I'm dumb. I cannot get this. I must be lacking in intelligence. But that whole scenario is based off of a lie. It's all about that fight that you're in. Because we start to believe that it's truth when it is not truth. We feel overwhelmed, so we must be overwhelmed. We feel awkward, so we must be awkward. We feel dumb, so we must be dumb. Are those any attributes that you feel like the Lord would say, I love you, babe. I created you to be awkward. Oh, I love you so much. I am the creator of the universe. I created you to be dumb. No, God does not say those things to us. The interesting thing is, if we are not serving God, who are we serving? Satan. A man cannot have two masters. So if you're believing the voice that says you're not good enough, you're not strong enough, you're not smart enough, you're not talented enough, you cannot be perfect in everything that you do, so why even try? That is the voice of the enemy, and you're serving the wrong God. Because your God says, I think you're amazing. Your God says, I think you're incredible. Your God says, I created you exactly how I wanted you to be. So when we feel anxious, when we feel like we're buying into these lies, when we're not fighting back, we feel isolated, defensive, hateful. We have attitudes, or we just get really, really busy, or we just get really, really quiet. But what is interesting in this is we take it on ourselves. For the longest time, it was really taboo to say, you know what, I feel anxious, I feel upset, I'm bothered by this. Society would say, okay, get counseling. But they would kind of avoid you. Well, how do we avoid 75% of the population? You can't. And in actuality, isn't that one reason God put us on this earth? To talk about the answer, to be beside your friend saying, you're in a fight. You are in a fight. You don't have to take these things on yourself. So where does fear come from? It's very interesting when you start looking into this, fear, anxiety, and phobias. Part of it is hereditary. Do you have an aunt, a mom, a dad, an uncle, a cousin that is always a worrywart, scared of everything? Like, you talk to them sometimes and then you get more scared and more worried about stuff just because they are? It can be hereditary. Another thing is it can be taught to you. If I'm scared of snakes and it comes in this room and I scream and jump, some of you are going to scream and jump without even knowing what I screamed and jumped at. Because I screamed and jumped, you're going to do it. My oldest daughter does not like spiders. She has taught my youngest daughter not to like spiders. I don't care about spiders. They don't even faze me. But my girls, they'll burn the house down. We have to move. And it was a plastic spider. It wasn't even real. Traumatic situations. If you're in a car accident, it's logical that you're going to have a hard time getting in a car the next time. If you're riding a horse and you fall off, the saying is, get back on the horse. If you have a traumatic experience, it can make it difficult for you to be in certain situations. The other thing is medical. There is an actual truth to the fact that sometimes our brains are imbalanced in certain ways and need help. There is truly medical reasons sometimes. Sometimes it's medication that you're already on that affects you medically. So a lot of these things you can be aware of, but you can't necessarily make a difference. But what you can make a difference is when it's spiritual and when it's Satan. You have every authority and every power to say those things are not going to be active in your life. In Ephesians 6:12, it says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms." Ladies and gentlemen, if you haven't looked at that scripture, I'm going to question if you've read the Bible. I'm visiting, I can say stuff like this. Seriously, you're in a fight and you're not even armed. I have a cousin who was born without any legs. She just has little, like, turkey legs. And we were in a situation once where it looked like we were about to have to throw down in the park, Melissa and I. And she's like, "I would kick him if I could, I promise. I would kick him if I could." You guys, are you handicapping yourself by not even reading the Bible and knowing what your powers are? It says we war not against flesh and blood. It's a spiritual thing. So how do you fight spiritually? You can start with 2 Timothy. God didn't give me this fear, and know where it comes from. But then we can also go to John 10:10, and it says, "The thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy." Satan is talking about you. He is coming to kill you and destroy you. Is that direct enough for us to understand that maybe we're in a fight? Part B. "But I, God, have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly." Abundantly. Not only are you supposed to fight back, you're supposed to win in a massive way. We found great satisfaction that kid was bleeding when he walked away from us. Whenever Satan is attacking you in your mind, find great satisfaction when you overcome him. Fear, anxieties, phobias, they're not your friend. They don't add a day to your life. They don't make anything better for you. But the good news is, you have the answer. The day that you said, "Jesus, I believe in you. I'm a sinner, and I believe in you," all of a sudden, he's like, "I got this." So being in that fight when I was 5 kind of stirred something up in me. And so I kind of got in quite a few fights growing up. And the thing is, I like to say it's because I have a protective nature. And my brother, who was a year older than me, had seizures. So there was a lot.